Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jordan Giesige, and this is The Limiting Factor. Images of the current collector plate from the top and bottom of the 4680 battery cell first began appearing online about a year ago. Since then, there's been a huge amount of speculation about what function they serve due to their intricate design. Today, I'm going to walk you through what functions I think they serve, which, in short, is that besides their obvious primary function to transfer electrical current, they also facilitate manufacturing, potentially lower resistance, and serve a thermal function. However, based on leaks from Cleanerwatt, at least one of the current collectors may be unnecessary and could be eliminated in future versions of the 4680 battery cell. Before we begin, a special thanks to my Patreon supporters and YouTube members. This is the support that gives me the freedom to avoid chasing the algorithm and sponsors. As always, the links for support are in the description. Additionally, this entire series wouldn't have been possible without the battery cell provided by Galley of Hyperchange and Corey Coddington, who delivered the battery cell to UC San Diego. At UC San Diego, Shirley Mung organized funding for the teardown as the Zabel Endowed Chair in Energy Technologies and Jacobs School of Engineering. And finally, Wai Kong Lee spent many hours working on the teardown and answering my questions. So, a big thanks to everyone involved. To kick things off, why do I refer to the objects we see on screen as current collectors? I spoke with someone who works at Tesla and other people who have contacts within Tesla, and all of them referred to this as the current collector. The name current collector tells us exactly what the primary function of these aluminum and copper plates is, which is to collect electrical current from the electrode foils and transfer it to an external terminal like the cell can. But that doesn't explain their intricate design. To understand that, we need to understand the construction of the 4680 battery cell. On screen is a diagram of a 4680 that focuses on the engineering around the positive terminal. There's quite a bit going on here, but we'll walk through each part and why it's relevant. At the top of the 4680 is a coin-shaped aluminum disc which serves as the positive terminal itself. How do we know it's the positive terminal? Because it's connected to the aluminum current collector and aluminum tabless electrode foils within the battery cell. Aluminum foil is always used for the cathode, or positive electrode, in lithium-ion batteries because it's stable against the high voltages that occur in the active material of the cathode. The cell can is the negative terminal, which we'll look at next in more detail. With the negative terminal and positive terminal in such close proximity, there needs to be some electrical insulation, otherwise the cell could short out and explode. The insulation is provided by the external gasket that sits below the aluminum disc and the internal gasket that sits above the current collector. You may notice that there are two things we didn't talk about here, which is the vertical connection from the aluminum disc to the current collector and the connection from the current collector to the tabless electrode. For the latter, the current collector is welded directly to the tabless electrode. With that piece of information in mind, the reason for the intricate design of the current collector now starts to become apparent. With the arrowhead sections of the current collector welded in place, we can see that the neck of the arrowhead effectively becomes a hinge point. Although the word hinge may not be the most accurate description of what's going on here, it's the best analogy that came to mind. The structural design around what I'm calling the hinge point allows the spokes of the current collector to flex, and the point of maximum travel would be the center of the spokes. That point at the center of the spokes is the perfect spot to rivet or weld a connection because it's both flexible and because the area behind it at the top of the jelly roll is empty space. And that's exactly what we see. The aluminum disc is connected to the current collector to complete the circuit. It appears there's some type of rivet that punches through the top of the cell can, and then the bottom of the rivet is welded to the center of the current collector. Let's move on to the negative terminal. This end is far simpler, so it won't require a diagram. First, we see the copper foil of the negative electrode, or anode. It looks flaky because the tabless electrode uses a series of cuts in the electrode instead of a single tab to carry current out of the jelly roll. Copper is used this time instead of aluminum because copper is stable at the low voltages of the typical anodes used in lithium-ion batteries, whereas aluminum is not. Other chemistries like sodium ion can actually use an aluminum current collector at the anode as well. We'll discuss that more when I do a technical deep dive of sodium ion. The copper tabless electrode is topped with a current collector. Once again, the current collector is welded directly to the copper foils of the tabless electrode. However, notice that the hinge point is reversed. The hinge is now in the core of the battery cell. This again allows the spokes of the current collector to flex, but this time the point of maximum travel is at the perimeter of the cell rather than the core. At the perimeter, there's also a flange with a groove. That groove allows the polymer ring fitted around the lid of the cell can to seat snugly against the current collector when it's crimped on to form the bottom of the battery cell. And, of course, as the lid of the cell can is crimped on to the body of the cell, the flange of the current collector hinges downwards. This forces the flange to form a tight connection with the sides of the cell can and makes the cell can the negative terminal. Interestingly, the bottom of the cell can is electrically isolated from the sides of the battery cell. Although it wouldn't hurt if the bottom of the cell can was also the negative terminal, a terminal there would serve no purpose. That's because Tesla's making all the electrical connections at the top of the cell. With that in mind, my view is that the polymer ring fitted to the lid of the cell can is there to seal the can, and just happens to also electrically isolate it. Before we move on, here's a side-by-side comparison of the two current collectors. The hinge points are in green, and therefore the point of maximum travel is in pink, which aligns to where the current collector is attached to the terminal, the aluminum disc for the positive terminal, and the cell can for the negative terminal. So far, I've said that the primary function of the current collectors is to collect current from the electrode foils, and that the intricate design was to facilitate manufacturing. However, I do expect that the current collectors serve two other functions. First, the shingled spiral of the tabless electrode means that any current flow from point X on screen would have to traverse layers of contact resistance if it took path B. Current takes the path of least resistance, and in my view, it's likely that the path of least resistance would more often be path A, because the current could flow through a solid sheet of highly conductive copper. This path of lower resistance would reduce heat generation, but to what extent, I don't know. Second, at the anode or negative side of the cell, the copper contact at the perimeter would provide excellent thermal conductivity to cool the interior of the cell. This is because the side cooling would work its way from the cell can to the copper current collector, to the tabless electrode, and then to the electrode foils that run through the battery cell. Moving along, what we see here is the first production iteration of the 4680. Would the current collector design be overkill, and is there some way to eliminate it? As I mentioned in past videos, the design does appear to be evolving. Images of a newer design first appeared at the Giga Austin event, which may indicate the internals of the cell have also been redesigned. This aligns with what Cleanerwatt is hearing from contacts inside Tesla. According to those contacts, the first production iteration of the 4680 is referred to as the first generation, and the second iteration we saw at Austin is the second generation, which is still in development. The second generation cell eliminates the current collector, and it's likely that the bottom of the cell is welded directly to the tabless electrode. The spiral pattern we see at the bottom of the cell in this image is supposedly a weld connecting the lid directly to the tabless electrode. That is, the current collector may have proven to be redundant and was removed. The best part is no part. Cleanerwatt also noted that the Generation 2 design is likely part of Tesla's push to combine notching, winding, and welding into one machine. If you'd like to know more about that, check out Cleanerwatt's video on the topic. It's worth noting that Cleanerwatt focused on the negative terminal of the battery cell with the copper current collector. There was no mention of whether the aluminum current collector was also removed at the positive terminal of the cell. My view, for now, is that the top of the cell is complex for a reason. The reason being that, for pack assembly, the positive and negative terminals are adjacent, which means there needs to be a method of electrical isolation between them, which results in all the engineering that went into the positive terminal. The negative terminal is a different story because there's no positive terminal to navigate, and therefore there's a lower risk of the cell shorting out. That means it may be possible to connect the copper current collector directly to the lid with a weld. How would that work? Here's my assumption. As we covered a moment ago, the reason why the intricate current collector was needed on the negative terminal of the cell was to help deal with the compression stress of crimping the lid to seal the cell. With the second generation of the cell, as we see here, it doesn't look like the lid was crimped on, for two reasons. First, there's no gasket like we saw with the first generation cell. Second, there's no crimp line around the rim of the cell. Here it looks more like the lid was pressed against the tabless electrode, followed up by welding at the rim of the lid and the spiral at the center. I say this because the metal appears to be blackened and charred at the rim and the center spiral. Welding the rim rather than crimping would reduce mechanical stress during assembly and negate the need for a flexible current collector to deal with crimping stresses. What about electrical current flows? Although steel doesn't have the electrical conductivity of copper, the distance traveled from the weld to the side of the cell can is relatively small. Much smaller, in fact, than the distance the current has to travel from the bottom of the cell can to the top. As for thermal conductivity, there's no insulating gasket at the bottom of the cell. The thermal pathway would simply be the bottom of the cell can, and the copper current collector wouldn't be needed as an intermediary. Copper does have higher thermal conductivity, but as we saw in the last video, a cell with a steel bottom provides plenty of cooling capacity. That is, the bottom of the second generation cell appears to be easier to manufacture while serving all the electrical and thermal requirements of the copper current collector. As a side note, the plug in the center would likely be for filling the electrolyte and might also serve a pressure relief function in the event of thermal runaway. In summary, the most likely reason for the intricate design of the current collectors is to facilitate cell assembly. The other functions of the current collector, such as collecting and transferring current, reducing resistance, and providing a thermal pathway, could have all been done with a design that was less intricate. And, at least on the negative terminal of the cell, it looks like Tesla's pursuing that opportunity. They teased a newer version of the 4680 at Austin, which Cleanerwatt has confirmed uses a simplified design with fewer parts. The lower part count will make Generation 2 of the 4680 cheaper to manufacture, and may help facilitate rolling several of the manufacturing steps into one. Furthermore, the current collector and the polymer gasket are inactive material in the battery cell that don't store energy. By eliminating them, it makes more room for active energy-storing material, which may help improve energy density. Troy Teslaik has leaked information suggesting that Tesla has three generations of the 4680 already on the drawing board. We'll have to wait and see how accurate the energy density figures are. I hope to provide an accurate energy density figure soon for the first generation of the cell, which will provide us with a good benchmark. If you enjoyed this video, please consider supporting me on Patreon with the link at the end of the video or as a YouTube member. You can find the details in the description. A special thanks to Mulad Zakar for your generous support of the channel, my YouTube members, and all the other patrons listed in the credits. I appreciate all of your support, and thanks for tuning in.